So it was more about the connection to the spirit of the town on our main street, which is Washington Street. And kind of form a design that would, the brief was to form a design that would kind of act as a catalyst to stop and maybe see the street and the environment in a new light.
So we were talking a bit about earlier about this sort of domestic scale of Columbus, that you have a corporate headquarters for a global Fortune 500 company that makes diesel engines, but it's on two stories. And so most of the buildings here actually are like kind of miniatures in their own way. So thinking about Columbus as a town, not necessarily a metropolis, the Washington Street project that you've initiated, I think, brings forth a couple different things. One is the Alexander Girard plan. I don't know if everybody, I don't, this isn't something that people in Columbus really talk about that much. Actually, it's something I never even really knew about until this kind of fresh set of eyes came onto the city. But he's an interior designer, or Alexander Girard, obviously, he did the interior of the Miller House. And he's working at an urban scale, sort of, in a way, I mean, I don't want to say decorating, but decorating the kind of this main street, which is a pretty, it's kind of an insane thing, actually, that that an interior designer would go and do an urban plan. So there's that aspect of Washington Street, and then also I think that's maybe what Productora, their installation, which is the small round like seats, the metal tops, kind of I think maybe picks up on that a bit. And then I think Cody's installation probably picks up on the other thing about Washington Street, which is these bricks, the brick project from I believe 1990, they initiated that and I remember that growing up. It was cool to see your friends' names pop up on the street here and there, and it kind of was an ongoing thing for a long time. So I guess there's those two aspects. Was there anything else about Washington Street that you were trying to pick up on, those are historically, I guess, the canonical reference points, but were there other ones that any of you picked up on?
No, I think what you mentioned is indeed very important for our installation. At the moment, we started investigating a little bit what could happen here. We were, of course, impressed by the legacy of modern architecture. But I think that the project by Girard for Main Street really, at a certain moment, is the same way he brought a sort of sensitivity to the Miller House. A sort of different view, which I think at that moment was very much needed in the...
No?
Yes.
So it's been off the whole time, no? I think. Now I hear myself. So I think this project of Girard for Main Street, for Washington Street, is really interesting because it's not only talking about the big heroic architectural interventions of these great names, of these selected architects, but it really also talks about the generic continuation of a streetscape, which was something that was kind of rediscovered at that time in the early and mid 60s. Some of these interventions by Girard, which were indeed, while we're rather decorative, even featured on the cover of the Architectural Forum in 1965, and was heavily criticized. Because for many people, I mean, you have to understand this moment when the discussion about postmodernism starts. It's the moment when Venturi starts to look at Las Vegas. It's a moment where all these elements start to come into play. It is that kind of tension between the existing and this modernist presence that we thought was like interesting to play with. So basically, what we did in our Columbus circles is a set of like these things.
These are one of them.
Exactly. We kind of do not only want to highlight these moments of modernist intervention in the city, but also like these pre-modern, very beautiful cast steel columns, or like this decorative wooden columns on the facade, etc., really much playing into that idea of Girard. And then, yeah, all of different other sets of things came into play, of course. Girard has always had an enormous fascination with Mexico. Actually, a large part of his collection comes from Mexico, since our office is based in Mexico City. We thought it was really interesting to kind of start to engage with that team. I'm going to pass the microphone on if I can talk hours about it. But in the moment you're invited to a project as such, I think you have to be, you have to understand that you can be only partially ambitious about this. It's a limited budget and a limited intervention, a temporal intervention. You know, it's going to stay there for a limited amount of time. It will not affect the city or the way the city works completely. In a sense that you have to understand that in the end, these kind of interventions, they are more sort of footnotes, so they talk more about the young work of the architect. They kind of try to talk, to kind of put certain ideas forward that you think are important in the discipline, more than really interacting on a continuous or daily level in the streetscape. So for us, it was very important to kind of do something which is something that, according to us, is part of our architectonical practice, in the sense that we insert very powerful or very basic geometric forms into different places. That's how our architecture always works, and we kind of see how these specific forms can be contaminated by its surroundings. And in the end, we always try to explain that whenever you insert a piece of architecture into an urban fabric, you should kind of try to evaluate how did the architecture really in the end change the surroundings, and not so much it's not about the architecture itself, it's about its relation to that surrounding. And so that's what we try to present here.
Do you want to just go back over what we initially started talking about?
Yeah.
What was the?
Well, I guess it was sort of, what were the things about Washington Street that you picked up on in your project?
Yeah, so maybe specifically in response to Girard, it was maybe this like call and response idea where the different projects on Washington Street and throughout Columbus put down at different times were referencing each other, and how Girard might have had sort of retroactively inspired himself doing different projects. So obviously, like, we know the Miller House textiles, the tapestry at North Christian Church, both of those things being referenced or referencing maybe some of the interior projects he did for Irwin Bank at 301 Washington. So I wanted to look around Washington Street specifically, being next to Hawkins, technically a renewal project, but being right in line with the brickwork that was already down was important to me. And I guess just following the precedent set with the bricks that were already ubiquitous in Columbus.
And what was that? What formally was the precedent that you picked up on?
Well, obviously like a grid, like a continuous grid, but the angles are pretty much 90 degrees and 45 degrees. I wanted to use that as kind of like the starting place to keep it without creating larger problems for myself.
Did you study the Kinnon project kind of historically?
I looked through the archives, yeah.
And what kind of stuff, what did you, like as a ceramicist, what did that, was there something that drew you to the idea of bricks?
Yeah, I guess in terms of Columbus, obviously there's just this massive presence of bricks, and you know, the library we're in right now is completely dominated, the entire block is dominated by bricks. The conceptual relation of bricks to progress and technology is, to me, pretty obvious too, and Cummins being an engine company and a technology, somebody who's pushing forward these new technologies that are tied in with progress and, you know, industry, that type of thing.
Yes.
Have you guys had a chance to, I know we were talking last night about some of your, have you had a chance to visit any of the buildings around town that you found inspiration from? Or
That's I think a trigger for many people, you know, like to be able to come to this town for many unknown and to kind of discover when you get the invitation, the richness this town has, and that I think it's a very convincing, factor in the decision making to do this here. I think the presence of all these innovative projects, both by designers, architects, and students, I think it becomes relevant through the historical legacy of that. And I think only as a sort of whole, it becomes a sort of interesting experience. I think also, I mean, for visitors driving over here, I think why can you do this in Columbus and not in a town 2 hours away? It is because of this this historical presence. And of course, that's what we've been doing with also the group from the gallery in Brussels. We've been kind of driving around in order to see as much as possible. The project we're doing here at Washington Street will still have a continuation in a project where February, March, or April next year. So it's nice that it doesn't stop here for us as well. So it kind of continues, and kind of this knowledge and this experience we take from this place, then we can kind of continue with it.
And have you studied the Girard Plan a lot as a place kind of for these interventions? I mean, when you did it, how did you choose the sites that you wanted these installations to go into?
The Paul Kennan installations, the brickwork, start between second and seventh, really, where he did design not only the patterning of the sidewalks, but also every intersection has a different geometric shape and laid it in cast concrete bricks, and the clay pavers on the sidewalks. So that became clear that section of Washington Street really kind of designated the downtown area. So the design brief is broad, where I did not assign a location, but let the designers interpret the brief in their own way. So I was hoping that none would overlap, but they very well could have. So the Girard was part of the story, but it was just kind of the Washington Street as a whole. And there's Productor like became these markers then to kind of highlight important markers. Like you could create a walking tour based on the whole concept that they developed, that these become markers of the significant buildings. And if you're a resident in Columbus and you might not know the historical importance in this circle is now on the corner, what does that mean? Maybe it causes you to ask questions about your surroundings. So I think a lot of times many residents don't know the importance. So I think having all these interventions along the street hopefully will cause some questions to be asked about place.
Yeah. Of course we wanted to do 20 of them, or 30 when we started working. So this is really interesting. How have you seen this story? Some of the ones that I think are intriguing is some relatively plain or banal facades on Washington Street, which have like this incredible interiors by Girard. And all this when you kind of put your face against the window that you can kind of look in. And I think these are kind of interesting opportunities to kind of have something of this insight, but also something of that decorative aspect you talked about, you know, like to have that brought into the street. I think that's really interesting. The problem with all these kind of public art installations, and we've seen many of them over the last decades, there's sort of a very strong limitation of materiality in the end. You know? Everybody has to work with very solid urine materials. So many of us have worked with with pavers or bricks or concrete or steel, which is kind of the material that kind of lasts as a public intervention.
Speaking of, I think what Jonathan was talking about a little bit, that sometimes there are these things hiding in plain sight here. You don't always, I think a lot of people don't always notice. And I hope that Exhibit Columbus brings out some of that, at secret histories, maybe, or like minor histories of Columbus. I was wondering, like, you were telling me last night that you went to Penn's Place, which is this is something that isn't super popular, but Gwaffney Siegel did a public housing project here. I was wondering what your impression of that place was. What did you think of Penn's Place?
Yeah, it's this typical intriguing paradox that I think it's an extremely thoughtful, very beautiful housing project, and seemingly none of the residents like it living there. But it's very beautiful, and it's very interesting the way it's resolved. It's something we're working ourselves on some social housing projects in the south of Mexico, and I immediately photographed all I could and found documentation, sent it to my office because it's a direct inspiration for things we're working on. And I think that's the only way. I mean, for me as an architect, the only way to really gather knowledge about what I'm doing. That's the problem with being an architect. You only get one chance to do something. Like if you're a product designer, you make a chair, you make a prototype, you try it, and if you fall off of it, then you're readjust it, and if it feels bad, you readjust it again until it's perfect. And as an architect, we never have that opportunity. So the only way to gain that experience, that trial and error process, is to kind of learn from the trial and error process of all these people that came before you. Because although sometimes architects claim it's all about innovation and new possibilities and new technologies nowadays, and yet many of these problems. We're working on the same issues for many, many, many decades, and I think that's very interesting. That's also why I think history becomes such an important part in the discipline as architecture, much more than in some other disciplines.
Yeah, like what about ceramics? Is there a similar kind of lineage that you would pick up on? And does this project is this project within the? This is the theoretical foyer. Is this within the kind of disciplinary boundaries of ceramics, or is it starting to bleed into something else, like urban design?
I mean, it fits within my personal studio practice. This is a really comfortable extrapolation of what I do on a smaller scale by myself in my studio. So this was an opportunity for me to take something that was a different material, very idiosyncratic process, and try to do something much larger and more ambitious, and break out of the materials I typically use to try something new and try something on more of an architectural scale. So this is the largest project that I've ever done artistically or creatively. It was, an adventure, and I wanted it to be a challenge. I also wanted to be present in Indiana and come here and spend time in Columbus and build it myself with my hands and be here and live with the people and experience the culture firsthand, see what that was like to actually be in a place, and I'm sure that anybody who has done a project here has spent some significant amount of time, walking the streets, spending time here. So that, yeah, it's my wheelhouse. It's something that I would eventually manifest either like on paper or in clay. But this project was the exact opportunity that I was looking for to do something this size.
And what were the challenges of moving from sort of the base scale or the vessel scale to the urban scale?
I have no experience on urban scale whatsoever. So spending a year troubleshooting, watching an idea evolve, watching a process emerge. It's a series of basic steps. It's really elemental. Like, the grid is so basic that it's almost full, as a kiddie proof in a way. So Jonathan helped me design molds that we had fabricated in Hoblet. concrete is really forgiving. It's, you know, it's cheap. So the elemental, the aspects of the work on their own are so simplistic that I could start nowhere and end up, you know, here. It was a process of discovery that was, at no point was it that challenging. Just, you know, specific things like how to lay papers. Anything that I had that was logistically a huge issue, I could figure out on YouTube in 4 minutes.
Is that nonchalance? I like that.
Yeah, it's 12, 14-hour days of casting concrete, so making it sound easy.
It wasn't physically enjoyable.
But. Right. I think something that has changed on Washington Street in the past 15 to 20 years is the kind of reclaiming downtown Columbus. So there was a 2020 plan around the year 2000 to kind of reinvigorate the downtown area. And started, I would say, like a big shift was the Commons Mall being repurposed and remade, restaurants and, you know, downtown activities, and kind of making downtown an area where people want to be back. I've been here 3 years and I'm already seeing like young families move downtown and new restaurants. It's nice to see that kind of reinvigoration of the downtown. So Washington Street then becomes this kind of the artery of the town, the main street of the town. And the rumor is true, you have to walk the alleys if you don't want to, you know, if you're in a hurry, just because you're going to run into a lot of people you know, especially in a small town. But I think that's kind of the charming nature of the installations, is that instead of rushing, you have this opportunity to kind of stop and maybe see the area in a new light. This has been really rewarding seeing the concepts come in, because the concepts for all five designers have evolved since the brief. The initial concept to the execution has changed quite a bit. Some of them drastically, some of them just in nuanced ways with materials and fabrication processes, but very much exciting seeing the new ideas come out of the following week.
By the way, Colin, I think it's a really wonderful piece, and I think that what I really like when I hear you talking about it is also, and I think that is the task of moments like this, like Exhibit Columbus, that you don't only just confirm what people are doing, but like in Dora's case or Cody's case, you kind of give them a sort of new task, you know, where we're not so much busy with with furniture design. So this invitation from Maniera, it's something new also. I know you never worked on an urban scale, of course, I know your work. So it's, I think it's, it has to offer these challenging moments to the participants. Otherwise it's just a sort of confirmation of a state of an already previously existing work. So that was for us very, very challenging and very pleasant to do in the end.
I think it's really cool, Jonathan, that you brought up the 2020 plan. Something I don't think has been really, I don't know, it hasn't really been mentioned a lot in all of the Exhibit Columbus stuff. I guess at least it's probably informed it on a community level, but maybe not so explicitly in the architecture. I don't know if that's a fair statement or not, but it's good to hear you bring that up. And I was wondering what's your overall kind of attitude or impression of what contemporary means today in Columbus? I mean, are the Washington Street installations kind of your vision of that in a way?
What is the 2020 plan?
Sorry, it's kind of like an urban revitalization plan.
Okay.
From when in the 90s and 2000s, the downtown was being replaced by sprawl.
Okay.
And so it was kind of like any good city has like a, you know, reorganization plan. The Commons is part of that, I believe, and there's some
Fourth
other
Street.
Yeah, Fourth Street improvements. parking garages.
Hotel Indigo.
Yeah, so that's something that's a little bit less explicit, maybe, but it's probably, and sorry, does that, what is your idea of like what Columbus is today in the face of what it has been in the past in relation to these projects?
I think there's just been kind of a fear of a few years ago that Columbus, like, it lost its way, or it's resting on its laurels. It's a museum of modernism, and I think in order to look at going into the future, you have to look into the past and see what's there. And we have this incredible foundation to build on, but to have new ideas that are in dialogue with the past and shining a light on what, like, the feeling like over time this history just, people stop asking questions about why and who produced the building. And through this process, we've been able to meet some of the fabricators that built the original buildings, and it creates a dialogue. The new creates a dialogue for what's going to happen in the future, where the ideas then have become a place to land.
I think that's a great place to actually wrap this one up. Do either of you have any other sort of, let's say, observations about your time here that you spent here?
No.
Okay. Great. Thank you.